Hello, I'm the nostalgic Nutcase. I remembered against my own free will. You know, when I was a kid, well, okay, younger, I remember watching this one weird trailer that popped up on one of my VHS tapes.
The balls are gone!
Well, okay, that one too, but I mean the other one.
Return to all the wonder and majesty of Disney's classic masterpiece as the story continues in an all-new animated movie. The Hunchback of Notre Dame 2, featuring the returning all-star voice talent of Demi Moore, Kevin Kline, Tom Hulce, and introducing Haley Joel Osment as Zephyr.
Whoa, wait. Introducing Haley Joel Osment? Okay. First of all, Haley Joel Osment was in Forrest Gump in 1992. They didn't record his voices for this movie until 1997, and the movie itself was never released until 2002. So, you're not exactly in the position to be saying that. And second of all, what took them so long? Why would it take 5 years to make this movie? And if you say animation, I will freaking break you. Okay, first some history. In 1831, Victor Hugo's Notre Dame de Paris was published, which was later imported to the States with the immortal title Hunchback of Notre Dame. Like Alice in Wonderland after it, it has been adapted to film about 100 times. Two of the most popular adaptations are the 1923 silent film with Lon Chaney Sr. and the 1996 Disney version, which is often praised for being much darker than any other Disney film at the time. And in 2002, we got a sequel.
I smell something rotten in Denmark.
And before I bash this crap to hell and back, I do have to admit one thing. The music in this movie is surprisingly decent. The four, that's right, four, songs range from okay to pretty darn good. And the orchestral score is actually beautiful at some points. Alright, I've delayed this long enough. Let's get going. The movie begins with our first musical number, and it is here that we notice something about the animation, mainly the fact that it sucks. Yeah, it's pretty bad. Like, imagine Return of Jafar, except consistent. That may be hard to imagine, but there you go. Anyway, the townspeople are getting ready for a festival called Le Jour d'Amour. Quick comparison check. This is the opening to this movie.
Le Jour d'Amour, your song is in the air. What magic will you make for us? What promise will you share?
And this is the opening to the first movie. Ah! Bizarre, right? It's like if they created a Mortal Kombat game with characters fighting rainbow monkeys. The townspeople celebrate this holiday by having couples take turns standing on a pedestal and proclaiming their love for each other while Quasi rings the world's most gaudiest bell.
Ah, Fidel, you are magnificent.
I honestly don't get it either. Like the other Disney sequels, most of the main cast actually return to give voices. All except for Tony J, for obvious reasons, and Mary Winkes, for obvious reasons. They even added some new characters, like Zephyr, played by Haley Joel Osment.
Charge!
I see dead people.
Getting back on track, Quasi, voiced by Tom Hulce, starts getting depressed because he doesn't have a girlfriend.
Someday you'll be ready. And when you are, you'll find her.
Someday? Nah. What could possibly ever change?
Hey, neither do I, and you don't hear me complaining.
What about that? Don't you want somebody to care about you?
Anyway, while Quasi sulks, Zephyr points out that the circus is in town.
Come one, come all, to Seth, to Sarouche. See juggling clowns, fire breathers, and magic.
After we meet our villain, we meet our love interest, Madeline, voiced by Jennifer Love Hewitt.
And the crowd goes wild.
You know we're in trouble when I'm wishing for Megara to show up. So Sarouche, yes, that is his name, comes in and explains that he is planning on stealing Loth the dumbbell.
I just want to contribute more to the circus.
Your job is to stand there and look pretty. Hello. Ooh, lovely.
Here's a short list of villains who are way more threatening than this guy.
Ooh, lovely. There's a bell ringer that lives in the tower. Smile at him, wile and beguile him, and he'll tell you exactly what I want to know.
Just brilliant.
Brilliant!
Brilliant!
So Madeline goes to Notre Dame to meet Quasi, and for some reason is completely unfazed after climbing a freaking bell tower.
Damsel alert.
And a lovely vision at that.
What am I, chopped liver?
No, but you are chopped Laverne. Quasi hides in the shadows as him and Maddie hit it off pretty well.
It looks like you're wearing a really big hat. It's a brass beret. A two-ton topper.
A chapeau in C-sharp.
Don't make puns, that's my job. I knew I'd use that dumbbell joke too soon. As they are joking, Madeline notices the gargoyles? Wait, what?
Never mind.
Anyway, Maddie sees Quasi's true face and runs off as Quasi sits down and mopes.
Do you believe in miracles?
Miracles? What kind of miracles?
Sentient gargoyles. And it is here that we have the best song in the movie.
Imagine someone to love who loves you. Imagine to look in her eyes and see.
Which, now that I think about it, isn't exactly saying much, but hey, it's not bad. It should be worth noting that one of the gargoyles, namely Hugo, is voiced by Jason Alexander. And no, you're not getting any Seinfeld jokes out of me. I never watched Seinfeld and I never really cared. But there is something else about this guy. Something else that just seems familiar.
What is this? So help me, I'll sue whoever runs this well!
Stupid! That was stupid! No, you can't see that was smart!
Continue?
Quasi? You can stay here and hope for a miracle, or you can get out there and make a miracle of your own.
Agreed.
You're right. I'm off to the circus. Oh, but what am I gonna wear?
I got the perfect thing, kid!
Well, how do I look?
Like a Montague. So they go to the circus as Phoebus, voiced by Kevin Klein, doesn't really approve of the circus people.
I don't want to lose you.
I don't trust these people.
What does that mean?
Well, just look at them. I mean, they travel from town to town like...
Gypsies?
Yes. No. I mean,
let me help you out, Phoebus. There is a huge difference between homeless people performing entertainment for money and a bunch of assholes who charge extra for the entertainment.
Don't do air quotes, Bob. It just annoys everyone.
Meanwhile, Madeline is refusing to go through with the plan, but Saru just tells her to suck it up.
You should have thought of that before you stole from me.
But I was only 6 years old.
And you were starving. And it was only a few coins.
You cratin', not so tight!
I made a mistake.
Yes. And did I turn you over to the authorities?
No.
Or the workhouse?
No.
And who took you in? Looked after you like a true friend?
You did.
Yes. All you need to do is to look pretty for him, and he'll tell you what I need to know. Mirrors? I could... kiss me, but I'd fall in love.
Okay, so he has portraits of himself covering the walls of his trailer that conveniently turn into mirrors with a push of a button, but that doesn't mean he's a narcissist, right? And then the circus starts.
And now, I will astound you with a feat of magic unparalleled in modern times. Behold, La Petite!
That's not La Petite, that's Mrs. Jumbo!
Do not look away from the beast, for I shall make it vanish before your very eyes. Adve Mysterium, Obscuro Elephantum, Mirabile Visu, Ecce Compacto!
Wow! Saroosh is incredible! I wish I could join a circus! Hey, maybe I could join a circus! Yeah! I could be a juggler! What do you think, Quasi? I'd juggle and I'd...
Quasi,
Quasi.
Hello.
What are you doing?
Nothing. You were making Google eyes at your girlfriend.
She is not my girlfriend.
I thought you forgot about me.
That will never happen. I'll always be here for you.
Always?
Always.
You mean if ever I'm in any kind of great big mess?
This song's annoying. Next, Maddie and Quasi meet up and decide to hit the town.
Paris is really pretty. You've probably seen it already, but then maybe you haven't. And if you haven't, then maybe we could, I could show you.
I'd really like that.
Meanwhile, everyone in town is claiming that they've been robbed as Phoebus tries to figure out who's responsible.
We'll find the culprits.
Where we'll find them, I don't know.
Wait a minute. What if these thieves may or may not have a connection to these shady circus people that just came to town?
Wait a minute.
A string of robberies begins the moment the circus comes to town? Coincidence? I don't think so.
Oh, great job, idiot. You know, I never know where he gets this stuff.
While on their date, Quasi points out the wonders of Paris in the not-so-wondrous places.
Oh, it's ruined.
No. Taste.
I think those are weeds.
Oh, no. Smell.
Oh, they smell so flowery. They're wonderful.
It's rosemary.
It's as if the theme of the scene is beauty can be found in anything, whether it be a deflated souffle, or a piece of rosemary, or maybe even a grotesque-looking bell ringer? Wink! This leads into a song sequence headed by the Gargoyles. Goody.
He's fa-la-la-la fallen in love. Fa-la-la-la-la. He's fa-la-la-la fallen in love. Sing a rousing, rollicking rondelay for our rip-roaring rhapsody.
You could do worse.
And since you're shaped like a croissant is, no question of she's gotta love a guy like you.
Yeah, like that. So Quasi takes Maddie back to his crib to dry up and shows her the bell.
It's beautiful.
Yes, you are. I mean, yes, she is. La Fidèle, that is. That's her name, La Fidèle. The faithful one. But she's even more beautiful on the inside.
I've got nothing. And so the day ends with Madeline kissing Quasi on the forehead. Isn't that sweet? Next day, Quasi asks Esmeralda for advice as Phoebus walks in accusing the circus folk.
I like the circus, Papa. I want to join.
Absolutely not. Those people.
Those people? How can you lump people together like that?
But the gypsies weren't guilty of crimes like these circus people.
He's got a point, guys.
Madeline's not. She's different.
Well, maybe. And maybe she's just using you to get something else.
Somebody's been reading the script. Back with Madeline, Sarush tells her that if she doesn't go through with the plan, he will do something unspeakable to Quasi.
I mean to have that bell.
I want nothing more to do with your thefts.
Oh, really? And how will you survive out there, On your looks?
Quasimodo sees something you don't.
Oh, does he? Well, what if he were to have an unfortunate accident?
Sarush, I would love to see you try. And so Sarush goes back to his trailer to look at his jewels.
Good night, everybody.
Ooh, lovely.
You know what I just realized? I could write a better sequel to this. I really could. It would be, Hunchback of Notre Dame 2, Frollo's Revenge.
You see, Frollo pretty much sold his soul to the devil in the first movie, right? So wouldn't it be awesome if he came back as some Lovecraftian eldritch abomination, bent on mercilessly killing all those who have wronged in the past, leading up to some climactic end-of-days battle, bent on world domination?! Moving on. Phoebus comes in and interrogates Sarouche. Sarouche, in turn, blames Madeline for the thievery.
Thank you. No, thank you, Captain. I'll let you get back to your self.
Speaking of which, Madeline and Quasi go for a walk while Sarouche steals a bell.
Ma petite chef de mort. Le bé.
What are you doing there?
Nothing.
Never show that again.
No, Madeline. The fool! Look at this ugly thing.
Oh. What did...
Ooh, lovely. I'm rich. Rich! I wonder if they make diamond underwear.
Stop it! Stop it! Please! I beg you!
So the bell is stolen and Madeline is arrested. How does Quasi react?
I'm playing the world's bloodiest violin.
So Phoebus decides to block all the exits, as we find out that Zephyr went after Sarouche. Smart kid there, Phoebus.
Phoebus!
Zephyr's gone after Sarouche!
I've looked everywhere.
I've got men all over the city. We'll find him.
You're looking in all the wrong places. Sarouche has made a living from illusion, but I can outthink him. It's the same as the disappearing elephant. There was always a tunnel under the stage. He's taken the bell underground.
The catacombs. He could be using the catacombs.
And she could be saying exactly what Sarouche wants her to. We go underground and he slips right out of town. Can't you see?
So let me get this straight. You don't want to search the catacombs because you think she might be lying to you. You, sir, deserve one of these.
Maka...
I mean, really? These are the undergrounds of Paris, and you're not even considering to check where the gypsies were hiding?
You are a bit annoying.
So yeah, they go down there and cut Sarouche off.
Bonjour, Capitaine!
Surrender now! You got no way out!
Really? I see things a bit differently.
Mama! Papa!
Let him go!
Don't test me, Captain!
Papa!
Lovely.
Quasi, listen to me. I know I hurt you. I'm sorry, but I am someone you can trust.
How can I? I've already made that mistake.
Quasimodo, there's more to me
than meets the eye.
Anyway, Quasi lets Madeline go and they run to the top of the cliff at convenience so that Madeline can save Zephyr by way of, ironically, a high wire act.
What are you doing here?
Just standing here looking pretty.
Oh yeah! Suck it, bitch! I will murder you!
And now there's the ending. I have to warn you people. This is the sappiest, corniest, most over-the-top ending ever to be put into a film.
Here.
I love
you know what? I don't care. I really don't care. I'm never gonna watch this movie again, so why the hell should I bother?
Quasimodo. You've shown me that the world is full of miracles.
Just ordinary miracles.
Just shut up and kiss already! Thank you!
Ever after.
Oh god, this movie is stupid. It's nothing more than corny ham and cheese smothered in schmaltzy sap. I mean, say what you want about Return of Jafar, Lord knows I have, but at least they followed up that piece of crap with a better movie. This soulless freaking film can rot in the blank, empty pit of purgatory till the end of time. Ugh. I'm a nostalgic nutcase, I remember against my own free will.
Angel in disguise, stories in his eyes, love for every true heart that it sees. Was it just a lucky day that he turned and looked my way?
Enjoy the skulls, people. That's about as dark as the movie gets.